Следващият ни лектор е не просто лектор, а департмент менеджер, отговарящ за системната верификация и валидация в първия Bosch Engineering Center София. Занимава се с софтуерно и системно тестване повече от 15 години и има редица успешно приключени проекти зад гърба си в областта на автомотив.
За първи път на QA Challenge Accepted ще се потопим в света на автомобилите. Антонета ще представи накратко архитектурата на колата, различните комуникационни шини в нея, стандартите и процесите, с които трябва да се съобразяваме, предизвикателствата, с които се сблъскаме, както и някои от тестовите инструменти, с които се работи.
Дами и господа, вашите аплодисменти за Антонета Антова Георгиева!
Здравейте! Hello! Which car is good enough for a test engineer? This is a question which we often have. Which one? Porsche, Lamborghini, BMW, Toyota, or maybe Volkswagen Golf? I will try in the next minutes just to give you some more information how to choose your car. Well, based on the McKinsey analysis in last years, it is planned 7% annual growth of automotive market from 2,338 billion to 476 billion euro. 140 billion on them are spent for R&D and one-third of the electronics and software. So, as you can see, there are a lot of money in automotive. We, as a test engineers and software developers, will do the best to spend them and to create really, really good cars in the future. So let's start the journey. In 2010, average car contains about 10 million lines of software code. Today, in 2020, a car non-automated contains about 100 million rows of code and 500 million a future automated driving car will contain. Just to compare, with the latest PCOS, this is about 50 million. So, I took with me this. This is exactly 1,000 pages. 1 million lines of code is actually 11,000 A4 pages. So, you could imagine how much software and how much information input into the ECU. But let's start the journey. Here, I prepared a wonderful picture of one car and how its architecture is made. I intentionally took automated driving car and you can see that the main ECUs and main architecture is presented. Powertrain, if you can see on the left, on your, actually my right side and your left side, contains the engine and gearbox transmission and also additional cameras for the all directions, front, back, blind spot detection. This is actually when you have a car near you and you cannot see it in the mirror. Since this car is fully automated and there will not be a driver inside, the network and in general collaboration between different ECUs should be really, really very good and very stable because there is nobody who to take the decision. Only the system will take a decision. Of course, just to somehow understand where are you going, your car should contain a navigation system and this navigation system should bring you from one point to another. In general, the car architecture in nowadays is something like this, the same, but ECUs are different and not only the cameras. I will go to say that due to this, a lot of standards we have to prepare, and this is, you can see them there. I will not go into details with them because starting from now, I have to speak till the next Thursday without interruption, and definitely will be boring. So, it's not possible to speak about automotive and not to pay attention about hardware and the mechanics. We, as a software and system test engineers, cannot divide slightly software and the hardware because we test them together. And when a hardware problem appears in it often and in most of the cases after deep analysis, we can determine that it's a problem of hardware, not of software. So when we are speaking about mechanics, a special type of materials we should choose, which have to have a low aging in the cars, they have to be temperature and also humidity resistant, vibration resistant. I took with me one ECU, which I'm working currently on. This ECU, as you can see, has its aluminium plate and special way how it should be mounted in the engine. It is, as you can see, closed everywhere. And this stuff is also used for a hardware radiator to make the hardware inside a little bit more cool. This is not that possible because here there is really a lot of electronics. When we're speaking about the hardware, we have to choose special kind of chipsets, and this kind of chipsets should be temperature and mechanically resistant. So we have to take care about vibrations and the plate PCB inside to be really, really good enough. And also we have to choose a humidity resistant materials, because I believe that none of you would like to have also problems during a heavy rain. Actually, when we are talking about hardware and mechanics, and for software, of course, we have to take care that only rockets and avionics have more severe technical requirements than us. In the past, when we were talking about automotive, typically for one and the same issue, there are more than one suppliers. That's why automotive manufacturers actually have a lot of problems when they started to make the system integration and vehicle architecture in the car. The problem was really serious because put together, typically issues refused to work. So, in 2003, most of the bigger automotive manufacturers like Daimler, BMW, also Toyota, GM, and two software suppliers and ECU suppliers, Bosch and Continental, sit together and decided to create a common automotive architecture. Main philosophy behind this is a very simple: reuse and hardware abstraction. Why this is needed? And it's very simple. Typically, automotive manufacturers have their own customized features which are put on the application layer, and this stuff has to be abstracted from the hardware. Most of you remember the earthquake in Fukushima part, when not only the nuclear power station was disturbed, near it, it was the plant of Fujitsu automotive microcontrollers, which stopped work for months. But meanwhile, automotive manufacturers could not stop to work on their cars. So then the software teams and hardware teams, part of automotive, has a really big challenge to change very fast microcontrollers. This is very easy with this new architecture, because this microcontroller abstraction layer fully abstracts the processor, and only changing processor and this layer, we can go to that direction that the system is fully functional. All the connections between applications are done within AutoStore runtime environment, and they could not contact together, which makes them really, really portable, and they can be put also on different ECU because all the interfaces there are standardized. I have two news for you here. First of them is that typically on this handle mostly software developer, but from other side, knowing about this architecture, test engineers of automotive should prepare some additional stuff and some additional tests related mostly to behavior and integration in the car. Currently, AutoSAR community have about 284 partners. Not all of them are there because some of them prefer not to be announced. But as you can see, almost all automotive manufacturers are present and part of this community. And also these manufacturers, you can see companies like Vector Informatik, Capit, Continental, Panasonic, and so on, which are deeply involved into AutoSAR development, and also some of the companies here provide also tools for this stuff configuration. As you can see in the part of core partners, Bosch is present. Core partners are the companies which sit together and actually define this architecture, and they also have the right to decide what will be changed and what additional news has to be introduced. Let's go to automotive specific buses and networks. First and most simple one is LIN. LIN actually contains one master and up to 15 nodes. And it works very simple. Master gives you the right to transmit and you provide your data. This is still used in the cars and mostly it handles sensors. It also handles very simple issues. Due to low speed transmission of 19.2 kilobits per second, it is not suitable to be used for some critical stuff like engine and gearbox and so on. Very simple things, for example, like mirror folding and so on. The next stuff, interconnects, actually somehow revolutionized the industry because in 2083, my company, Robert Bosch, started and released the CAN network. There is no, I would say that there is no car in the world now without this network installed. And actually for the 86 and 87, it was really a revolution. First car where this network is introduced is BMW 1988 model and this is BMW 8 series. BMW announced there that a partially implementation of this network leads to saving of 850 meters of cable. You can imagine how heavy this is and how much money they saved on this. The first car in the world built with CAN networks is Mercedes S-Class from 1991. Why this is a revolution? Before CAN, it was like this in the picture. You can see each ECU should be connected to each ECU, which means a lot of cables. When CAN was introduced, you can see that here we have only one network. Each ECU can be contacted there by address. Next network is FlexRay. Speed there is significantly increased to 10 megabits. And actually it is somehow related to safety critical and time critical system. In this network, the new thing which is introduced is that it has two lines and in the same time ECU can transmit in one or both lines and this is done relatively safe and error-proof. Unfortunately, this network, due to a lot of cables which it has, is very, very expensive and that's why it somehow loses its popularity. It was created by a consortium and this consortium is already dismissed. Next network is the first try when the automotive manufacturers try to put plastic fiber optic in the car. This is MOST. It is created for automotive, but afterwards it goes to an additional different system. New thing here is that in the data package we have streaming synchronous data, which is audio and video, and together in the package we have also asynchronous data, which is internet traffic and some information from the navigation system. Of course, it's not possible to have such an expensive and stable thing like Ethernet and not to try to put it into the car as well. Currently, on Ethernet communication, we could see that there is implemented diagnostic, this is DOAP protocol, and also it is widely used for in-vehicle infotainment, especially in last years when we would like to have the features from the smartphone integrated in the car. Into detail there, because it is the standard Ethernet package which you can see actually in each network, I mean even computer one. The only significant difference is that Ethernet actually has two wires instead of four, which leads to some cable savings. In general, it's not that cable savings is something very important in the car. It is that we as part of the teams who create cars, we are fighting for each gram there. And saving a lot of cable means that our cars will be lighter and actually the acceleration between 0 and 100 kilometers per hour will be faster. Well, as I said, it is not possible to have software without having a hardware. Here with me I bring some stuff. As you can see, this is something which can simulate in the same time work on two CANs and up to 16 Ethernet networks in the car. Here you can see a network. This can simulate CAN, LIN, FlexRay and also it can simulate Ethernet. In some of the stuff, we can have also this stuff. This is limp piggies, for example, and depending on the firmware of the device, the company vector gives us a really good possibility to somehow make the stuff in the way we would like it. For example, I might not need the CAN, but I might need LIN, so I simply can exchange this transmitter in the device and just use it. In some of the ports, there are two networks combined together, so also the companies suggest different cables. For example, this could split Ethernet, this could split FlexRay and CAN. First tool which I would like to speak about is Vector Canoe. It's the same manufacturer like here, like Vector. They produce actually this to support the network. Here, this star which you can see, you can see actually the single ECU is our ECU, and there you can see the connections between it and other ECUs which it's communicating with. This is what you can see when you start your canoe, and to have this started, you should have at least one of these put on the table. Canoe gives us also a possibility to have some manual fast checks, and this is one of the panels where you can check lane detection of the stuff, you can check the navigation, and just to see that everything is going smoothly. For the automated purposes, there is additional stuff. Unfortunately, I could not show you a screen on this because we have to have configured project, which is unfortunately confidential and cannot be shared on a conference. Of course, Canoe gives us also additional runtime stuff, and these are the traces which you can see how the CAN network and in that case Ethernet network changes, with the possibility to open a message. This is downwards window where you can see the significance of bytes and bits in the message. Sometimes we have to check how one message changes its values during the time, so Canoe also provides possibility to create such kinds of oscillograms, and after that to check if the form of the signal which we are testing is exactly the same which is specified. Of course, the next tool is VTest Studio. It is also produced by Vector, and because Canoe itself gives us possibility to create scripts, Vector also suggested additional possibility for us to create models. This is something similar to MATLAB models, but made a little bit more simple and more user-friendly and more easy to use. Here you can see one test case where we should test something in left direction and in right direction. It's very easy to visualize this to auditors, to customer, and even to explain your colleagues what it behind. It's very convenient when you have to check a different algorithm just to have it written and to be able to see all the things which are checked. Based on this diagram, VTest Studio provides a possibility to generate a code which is directly integrated with Canoe, and you can simply put one exe file and after that you can execute the test cases. You can also comment here test cases, and if you need to test only left part, you can comment right part and to generate only code which contains left part only. This is the most interesting tool I would like to think to say about. Here you can see a virtualized world where we can test autonomous driving features. Here you can see a simulation when a pedestrian suddenly appears when the simple car is driving backwards. Actually, we can virtualize all the stuff which we have. We can have virtualized buildings, we can have virtualized roads, and we can have virtual pedestrians. Of course, you could imagine that it's not that possible to have this done with real people because of software bugs. Unfortunately, we also have some. And we could not kill people, actually. And I believe that we will not be definitely able to have some pedestrian volunteers to be killed. Typically, we have a joke, and actually it becomes a tradition. First person who is real pedestrian is project manager of the project. He is the first pedestrian. The last tool I will speak about today, it is ADTF tool. Here you can see one video. This video is actually recorded to be able to have tests just if our issue recognizes these green labels which are above the road. So when we take this video, as you can see, they intentionally look only mostly on that labels. We can put it into the tool, and after that we can see something like this. As you can see here, here we also have raw stuff, and it is different when you have a really clear and shiny weather. It is different when you have rain and if you test during the night. We also can have such raw stuff done also during the snowstorm, during the fog, but don't expect too much from the camera in the fog, especially in Tiquan. It also cannot see and cannot predict. After this is put to the tool, you can see that a lot of noise was removed, and actually you can see a clear picture where is the road and where are the buildings. And after that, this is given to our issue and it could analyze and do the job. Here we are talking about front camera. And one of the things which is really the biggest challenge for us is testing in the car. You can see two spy pictures which I found in the internet, because in general it's forbidden to take spy photos of the cars, and you should avoid everything which you can do here. So you have to fight with unstable environment, possible timing issues, because when you are testing on the bench, you have a stable environment, a stable timing simulated by Canoe and by this stuff here. In the car, you put different issues together with different level of maturities, and it's not a surprise if they cannot work together. Also, we have to choose really experienced people who know also the architecture of the car, which sometimes is a challenge. It's a big challenge because typically this is confidential and it's not provided by automotive manufacturer. In the car, you can make only positive tests. All the negative tests are forbidden, and especially the stuff related to under voltage, over voltage, and checking the DTCs, because this might lead to damage of the car. And last but not least, you have to fight seriously with legal and security limitations, because, let's say the very simple example, if you go and would like to buy some water, it's not good to go to the supermarket and do it, stop in the parking there. You should go and find some more lonely place, let's say. You should not open the door and whatever. And of course, to do this, you should have also the special driving license, which is a special regulation. Safety first. I didn't put this just because I'm a fan of this. It is really needed because you have to be prepared for everything, and you should also be prepared with additional team on place. You can ask my colleagues there. Here, they go with wireless chargers on the road many times to save the colleague. Maybe it's time to return to the question, which car is good enough for a test engineer? And for me, the answer is very simple. Any car which is built according to the rules and follow the processes is good, but it's a matter of what you like, actually. So it's fun, you can see that it's fun. So maybe it's time for questions.
Are you using image annotations and image segmentation to teach the AI for the self-driving functionalities?
It depends, actually. There are some automated systems. If it is something with on-display features, we could use some cameras and additional implementation. If it is something which actually produces the image, we can use different stuff depending on the tools. Artificial intelligence is something which is very modern in our days, and yes, sometimes we use it.
Okay, thank you. And another one, I hope it's for you again. How are you defining positive, negative tests on your project? How can you be sure that negative test is not possible variation on real road, for example?
Negative test, for example, which is not possible on the road, is when you would like to change the tires when you are driving. Typically, this is done via CAN network or via FlexRay network, changing a signal. But I believe that none of us can drive with 140 and change four tires in the same time. This is a definitely negative scenario which I will not plan to be executed.
Okay, there's one new question. How do you handle test failures upon detecting an issue with a system built in the car? What's the process for fixing the issue?
Well, I will try to be very fast because I see that I have very few seconds on this. In general, there is a strictly defined process. When we have a problem in the car, we should lock some information which to be provided for later analysis to development. We do process-wise the same. We should enter a defect into our defect tracking system and immediately to inform development and project manager about this issue. After that, to participate in together debug session with development and even to go together with the car. It's not. It's actually a teamwork because it's not just I did this and that. I write the steps, but. This is in general nothing different. We simply have to take logs and we simply have to reproduce it on a bench.
Okay, and last one, it seems like it's liked question, so it seems more of one people wants it. Why are negative tests not executed? My point is that damaging the car is not a better option than damaging the pedestrian or passenger driving.
Negative test cases are not executed in the car, but they are executed on the bench. So car is in general is not suitable because the cost of one such car is something like 1 million, 1 million 300 euro. And I believe that none of us would like to be on the place of the test engineer to explain to, for example, Daimler, sorry guys, I just broke the car, and in general it's really a problem because they have, for example, 5 cars for all Daimler and for 150 use, so that's why.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I hope you can answer the last questions in Discord. Okay, can you?
Yes, I will try to answer questions in the Discord, and also my mail will be present in the last slide of the presentation. So if somebody would like to contact me, please use LinkedIn and mail. We can discuss. Okay. And also you can find me nearby. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Аплодисменти за Антонета.